Good morning, viewers. Welcome back on this lovely Saturday once again, and a very, very, very interesting topic, falling in love again. So how many of you are in love? Today, one person who is always in love with life itself is here with us, Dr. Ali Khwaja, and he will take us through this journey on love and what is love. Also, let me tell you, this is the first in the series. The next one which is coming up is Happiness is a Journey, and followed by Create Inner Freedom. So today we start with Falling in Love Again. Welcome you to Team Banjara.
Very good morning to all of you. Let me start off with asking you a question. Do you believe in love at first sight? I know the answers will be very varied. Some will very vehemently say, no, it's stupid. What do you mean love at first sight? There will be others who say, I've been married for X years now, happily married. But I remember the first time I saw my spouse, I fell in love with him or her. So yes, if there is love at first sight and it lasts almost like a lifetime and things like that. Then of course, there will be all those very deep thinkers who will say, depends, sometimes, if this happens, if that happens. So they'll try to apply logic to emotions, which is one thing which I keep on requesting, please do not do that. Emotions don't follow logic. You know, in reality, what happens? Every one of us, sometime or the other, has fallen in love at first sight. You may say, no, not me. I'll explain to you. You see a person, the time when you are available, free, you know, ready to mingle, that sort of thing. And you are in that, you know, stage of life where you feel that, yes, I am open to having a partner or something of that sort. At that point of time, you suddenly see somebody, and at that moment, there is a strong attraction. Some chemistry takes place, and you feel so strongly attracted to that person. You continue. You make friends with that person. You find that that person is really good, and then you make friends, and you start interacting. Then you go closer, and then a friendship develops. Then a love develops. Then marriage takes place, and you're very happy together and things of that sort. And you say, see, it was love at first sight. Compared to that, there are innumerable occasions where you look at a person and you are very, very attracted to that person. And you think of it as, you know, this is something, you know, amazing. I've never seen a person so good, so nice. You even start talking to that person and you realize that person has got so much of things to attract you and such wonderful traits and the way he or she talks and attitudes to life. So many things happen. And then you say, I must make friends with this person. So you say that, can I drop you home? And she says, no, my husband is coming to pick me up. He should be here any minute now. Poof. That huge cloud that was building up above your head suddenly disappears. Oh, yeah. Okay, convey my regards. Okay, so fine. See you. And you push off. And within no time, you forget that you had this attraction. You just accept this person as part of your maybe social circle or this or that or something of that sort. So if somebody asks you, do you believe in love at first sight? You say, no, nothing of that sort. Yeah, maybe later on you found a partner, you moved on in life and things like that. Why I started off with giving you this example is that I want you to understand that love is basically an emotion. We start off with, you know, developing a particular emotion towards a person, which can be love, which can be like. There's another aspect to it, which I'll just touch upon, but will not go too deep into it. Please remember, sometimes people think that I started liking this person, then I started loving this person, as though it's a sequential thing or a prerequisite like a probation. So first I was on probation, then I became permanent or something of that sort. No. Liking and loving are not necessarily sequential. you may like a person and then start disliking a person, forget about love, everything is over. You may love a person, but you may not like a person. That is very interesting. How can that be? If I don't like that person, why should I love that person? Look around. You will have friends who will say, I love my spouse, my child, my father, anybody. I love that person immensely. But that person has got so many characteristics or qualities or habits which I hate. So do I like that person? No, I don't like that person. I like my neighbor's child. I like my sister's child. They're such wonderful children. My brat, horrible fellow. But I love him. That is why I told you right in the beginning, don't try to apply logic to emotions. When you love a person, you love a person. At the same time, let us now go into the topic. I didn't have a topic saying continuing to love or nurturing your love or strengthening your love on a long-term basis or something of that sort. I gave a twist to the topic. I said falling in love again. Whereas I'm sure most of you believe that you fall in love only once. Hey, it's for a lifetime, man. I'm not such a frivolous person that I'm going to keep falling in love again and again and again. Including people who have fallen in love, got into a relationship, and the relationship broke. Even they say, no, it's not going to happen to me again. I did fall in love. It didn't work out. The relationship is not good. Now I am grown up. I am mature and this and that. I look at life much more objectively. Yeah, I may be open to a relationship. I may like to have a partner in life, or I may want to do certain things and all that. But I'm definitely not going to be falling in love. That is immature. At that time, see what happened? At that time, I was so immature. I got taken in, and that's why I fell in love. And then I gave the best to my relationship. Nothing happened. Something of that sort. Now, even that needs to be given a little bit of a, you know, thought. How? Let me tell you. You know that the brain is the last frontier of medical science. And we know much less about the brain than we know about any other organ in our body. But in the last few years, neurology, that is the study of the brain, has progressed significantly. A lot of research has gone into it. Today, for example, take a simple thing like a brain tumor. Maybe 10 or 20 years back, a brain tumor was a death sentence. 95% of the people with brain tumor used to pass away. Today, if caught early, if I develop a brain tumor and I get a checkup done fast and I go under proper therapy and care of a neurologist or neurosurgeon, as the case may be, there's a 90% chance that I can recover from brain surgery. Okay. Why I'm telling you this is to help you to understand that neurology has progressed tremendously, and they have come out with something very interesting. They say that when you claim to fall in love, it is actually a physiological phenomenon. We have all these tiny, tiny, tiny wires all over the brain. It's like a very complicated CPU or something. You know, you open a machine and you see inside all sorts of red, blue, green colored wires crisscrossing and stuff like that. No, the brain is something like that. It's got innumerable wires inside. They're all supposed to be connected. The miracle of nature, as I call it, beautifully connected at the right places to the right thing, so that when you will your right hand to lift up, only the right hand lifts. When you want one finger to go down, only one finger goes down. Why is all this? Because these wires in my brain are so perfect that they can give exactly the correct orders to my body. Okay. Now, what they found out was that when a person falls in love, there is a change in the brain chemistry. The wiring changes. It is almost the same as what happens when you get intoxicated. If you get into some sort of substance abuse, be it cigarette, be it alcohol, be it drugs or whatever it is, when you get intoxicated with any form of chemical psychotropic substance, your brain chemistry gets altered. And that is the reason why you see a person whom you saw during the daytime, who was a perfect gentleman, talking very politely and nicely, behaving very well, very responsibly. You meet him in the night when he is drunk and he's using all sorts of abusive words. He has become violent. He cares for nobody and he's talking something totally irrational. And you may wonder what happened within a few hours. And the beauty of it is next day he's back to normal. Next day again he behaves in such a mature, such a kind and compassionate way and all that. And you say, is this the same guy? What happened to him last night? How could this fellow go bonkers? Didn't he realize whom he's shouting at? He tried to argue with the cops and he got locked up in the police station. Or he got into some argument with his boss. He got drunk and went to office and he got into an argument with his boss and he lost his job. I mean, doesn't he know the responsibility that he has? Why did he do it? Why he did that was because his brain chemistry at that moment, with the help of that intoxicant, got rewired. Rewired in such a way that he started doing risk taking. He didn't mind. He started focusing on himself. He didn't care for what's happening to others. And therefore, he behaved in the way he did. Now, as I told you, next day is back to normalcy when that effect of the intoxication goes down. Now, falling in love is something like an intoxication. You're not taking any chemical into your body, but nonetheless, you are getting into a state where your brain wiring gets rewired. And you cannot see beyond whatever you are looking at. The object of what you have fallen in love with, the person who you have fallen in love with, becomes the most perfect person in the whole world. And of course, as I keep reminding, right from our childhood, we have been indoctrinated, intoxicated also, I would say, with fairy tales, with all these stories about they married and they lived happily ever after. All these Bollywood, Sandalwood movies, all these romantic novels, Mills and Boone, those sort of things. They've all been constantly reinforcing the fact that once you fall in love, you find the right guy and that's it. You live happily ever after. But it doesn't happen that way. So what do neurologists tell us? That the same way as the effect of the intoxication goes away in a few hours and you come back to the rewired brain, the same thing happens when you fall in love. You are intoxicated and you cannot think rationally. You are obsessed with the object of your love. You don't listen to anybody who tries to put in some rationality into you. And you are willing to take risks, like how the person under intoxication does. You are willing to fight the whole world and things like that. Now, it doesn't happen in a few hours, but definitely in a few weeks or a few months, the brain starts rewiring itself back to what was its original condition. So what does it do? It makes you fall out of love. Neurologists tell us now that the maximum that you can say, maximum, you can stay in that state of fallen in love is about 12 to 18 months, which is a very long period. Most of us don't last that long. So whether it is 12 months, whether it is 3 months, whatever it may be, the day comes when we fall out of love. It's like the person waking up after a long sleep and all the effect of his intoxication is over and he looks around and he says, hey, what have I done? Where am I? Etc. The same thing happens when you fall out of love. So when you fall out of love, you look at your partner and you wonder and say, is this the knight in shining armor that I married? Is this the great prince who had no flaws? Or the man says, is this the beauty queen that I married? Is this the great princess who has no equal? No, it doesn't seem to be that way. Now, that is not as horrifying as you would think. When you fall out of love, it doesn't mean that that's the end of your relationship or end of love. Only when you fall out of love, you start loving. And that is the love which has a meaning, which has depth, and which has long-term consequences. So the faster you fall out of love, the faster your honeymoon phase with the person is over. You start nurturing, cherishing, and developing a relationship which can last a lifetime. At the same time, now that we know that this is how the phenomenon works, you fall in love, you fall out of love, then you start loving, and you decide that, yes, this person is wonderful. I want to build a good relationship. And I'm not only talking about relationships. Let's say it's a parent of yours. Now you're an adult. When you look back, you say, one of my parents didn't treat me as properly as I would have liked to. That person, you know, did harass me. That person scolded me. That person put me down. That person compared me to my siblings. That person did not, help me to build myself up and brought down my self-esteem. All that happened, right, isn't it? But you say, okay, now I have accepted it. All said and done, this person is my parent. And now that I'm grown up, I'm going to have a one-to-one relationship with my parent, and I'm going to continue to have a good relationship regardless of what may be my complaints. Same thing with a child. You may have a child who grows up into teenage or adolescence and starts behaving badly according to you. And initially, you may be extremely angry. You may be very exasperated. But if you can fall out of love with your child, you can say, hey, this guy has got certain very irritating qualities. This guy is incorrigible in A, B, C areas. But nonetheless, he's got some good qualities. We share a good bond. We can improve and, you know, strengthen and bring our bonds much, much closer. And we can lead a good life. That is what I meant by saying you start loving your child after that. Now, what happens after that? You continue. But remember, there is no such thing as unconditional love. You cannot expect a relationship, particularly a close and loving relationship, to just float on its own. And that's what I meant by saying there is no such thing as lived happily ever after. One girl had brought this out so beautifully to me. She said, I love my guy. Yeah, fantastic guy he is, you know. I really love him. I would not trade him for anything, and I feel that he's the ideal person for me. She said all that, and in the same breath she said, you know something, today I love this guy. Tomorrow, who can predict the future? I'm not an astrologer. So all I know is that today I love this guy. And I will tell this guy that I love him. But I'm not going to say, I will love you for the rest of my life. I will love you to my last breath. I will love you for the next seven janmas or something of that sort. So today I'm reiterating that I love my guy. And this my guy was sitting right there. And he gave a very sheepish smile and he says, almost every day she says this to me. We've been married for 53 years. 53 years. And she says, yes, all these 53 years I've loved him. Even today I love him. Maybe I love him much more than what I loved him 50 years back. But tomorrow I cannot predict. He may do some horrible things and I may not love him. That is what I want you to think. Anybody else will say, what a stupid woman. You know, what is she trying to say? How can she make conditions like this? You have to be committed and you have to. She is committed. She's not saying I'm not committed. She's only talking about this emotion called love. If you ask her, if your man does something horrible, will you leave him and go away? She'll say, no, I'll never leave him and go. But whether I will love him or not is not in my control. No, it's an emotion. I may still take care of him if he becomes an extremely nasty character. But he needs my help. He's grown old and he needs me to look after him. I look after him, but I'll do it as a duty. I won't do it out of love. Let's understand that basic thing, that love cannot be taken for granted. Love cannot survive on its own. Love is like a delicate sapling. When you fall in love and when you decide that I want to have a good relationship with this person, it is like you have planted a seed and you want that seed to sprout, to come up, grow, eventually become a huge tree, and for the rest of your life give you shade or fruits or whatever it is. Yes, I accept. Mr. Venkatesh says loving is accepting each other's imperfections. That's a very important thing. I'll come to that in a minute. So what happens is that every loving relationship has to be constantly nurtured. Even if you have been married to your partner for 53 years, even if you are the child of your parent who is now 90 years old and you are 60 years old, you still need to nurture your relationship. You've given birth to a child and you've given that child everything perfect, and the child is growing up happily and you've shared a very good relationship. The child is 10 years, 13 years, 16 years, 19 years, whatever may be the age, you still need to nurture your relationship. And one of the ways of doing that is the topic of today. Can you fall in love again with the same person, not with a different person? It's so easy to fall in love with a different person. When your relationship becomes monotonous, if it is taken for granted, if there's no variety or excitement or romance or whatever, you know, adventure in that relationship, it's so easy to drift away. And then if somebody very, very attractive comes into your life, it's so easy to fall in love with that person, because it goes by that old English proverb, grass is greener on the other side. Whatever you see far away looks much more attractive than what you see under your feet. So as I said, it's so easy to get distracted and to fall in love with somebody else. It's not that easy to fall in love again with the same parent, same spouse, same child, same best friend, same whoever it may be. But while the falling in love for the first time may have happened without your realizing it, it just was an emotion that came from within. You felt attracted to this person. You felt nice about this person. You kept nurturing that bond between you and that person. And at a certain time, it grew into a very loving relationship, right? But you don't know, it may be faltering. You have brought up a tree beautifully. You've done everything from watering the plant, protecting it from animals, seeing that the weeds are removed, fertilizer is given, shade is given. You did everything till that tree grew up into a gigantic tree. Now you are very complacent. You say this tree doesn't need water. This tree doesn't need fertilizer. It's already a huge tree. It's giving shade, fruits, whatever it is. But it does have its needs. For example, a huge tree like that can be hit with an attack of white ants. The white ants may get into its trunk and start nibbling it away. Sometimes you can't even see it because it's happening inside. And you see this huge solid trunk, the main trunk of the tree. And one fine day you realize that it is hollow and there is a heavy rainfall, and that day it just crashes. And you wonder what happened. Such a strong, such a good, such a well brought up tree. How could it have fallen like that? It was because of your neglect. We do the same thing with some of our loving relationships. I may take my parent for granted. I may take my child for granted. And I may definitely take my partner for granted. We understand each other. We know everything. We have been together for years and years. We know. No, it doesn't. People change. People's needs change. And equally important, people's wants change. Never forget the difference between needs and wants. A husband comes in, wonderful, Satyan was busy falling in love again with his wife. Hearty congrats, Satyan. You're a good role model to so many others. Okay. So, we need to understand and accept that we need to nurture each one of these relationships. Somebody asked, what's the difference between crush and love? Yes, crush is what we refer to as infatuation. It is an impulsive reaction. It can be in positive, it can be negative. I can develop a crush, I can get infatuated and, with the person and fool myself thinking that I'm in love with that person. It can be minus also, I can hate a person just because he made a face at me or he said something nasty to me, so he's a horrible character. These are all impulses. It's a different topic altogether. Maybe someday we'll deal with it. How you should resist being impulsive. You should never do things based on that momentary thought or that momentary emotion that comes up. Sandhya says, in love only accepting should be there and expecting is wrong. No. In fact, Sandhya and all of you, I want to tell you, there is no relationship without expecting. I was just going to come to that anyway. When you have a loving relationship, you have to have expectations. The only person with whom you can have that relationship without expectation is with Almighty God. If you are a believer in God, you don't question what good or bad he is doing and what sort of relationship. You don't tell him, I pray 4 hours a day. This stupid neighbor of mine, not even once in a month he goes to the temple or gives any charity or does any puja. And you gave him a promotion and you didn't give me a promotion. We don't question God. We still continue to be having this loving relationship. So other than that, all other relationships are based on expectations. But relationships get spoiled when your expectations go beyond what the other person can give you. That is exactly what I was coming to just now. That you need to understand not only the needs but the wants of a person. A husband comes back very late, very tired, very irritated, and he says, give me a cup of coffee. The wife says, it's already 8 o'clock, it's dinner time. Don't spoil your appetite with coffee. In 15 minutes, I'll give you a nice hot dinner. She's going out of the way to be nice to him. She's concerned about his health. She's leaving everything else and being at his service. But he's getting irritated. I wanted coffee. I don't want dinner. He walks out. And she says, what's wrong with this guy? What she, neglected to understand was that along with his needs, there are certain wants. Okay, at that moment, you may do whatever you want, but do you sit down and discuss and say, when you come back at 8 o'clock and you ask for coffee, how do we, resolve it? I feel that's not a nice thing to do and I feel it will spoil. What do you feel about it? He may have some other explanation. He'll say, I'll have dinner after 1 hour, but I need to cool down because I had a bad day, I was stressed out or whatever, those sort of things. These are the things. So what I want you to understand is that when you love somebody, or rather you have a loving relationship with that somebody, don't even fool yourself that you're always loving a person. No. Sometimes the love has gone out of the window and it becomes more of a responsibility, a routine, a sort of, duty to take care of so-and-so and all that. Whenever that happens, please question yourself, am I at the right point? And ask yourself, how can I fall in love again with this person? Because I have so many years ahead of me and I want to have a loving relationship. How are we going to consciously fall in love again? And what are going to be its consequences? I will tell you, as they say in the TV serials, break ke baad. It's not actually a break. I've just requested our director, Purnima, to share a few thoughts on this topic with you. And then I'll be back in a very, very short time. Over to
falling in love again and again. So it is our attempt at Banjara.
It is, in fact, our mission at Banjara to spread the message of understanding, spread the message of empathy, self-awareness, being able to manage your own emotions. And love is an emotion, as Dr. Ali mentioned. And also to check the, you know, self-esteem, everything. These are all the different attempts that we have from our end to bring that message across to you. And Dr. Ali today speaks to you on falling in love again. And these are the varied topics which are of human interest. And considering that we have festival time, we have weekend, we will be more than happy if you can spend some little time with yourself alone to introspect on whatever has been, you know, spoken. You may have questions with regarding to this topic that what if I fall and I get hurt? Ask Dr. Ali. So what to do if you get hurt? Some of you may feel, what if I have fallen in love, but I don't get, you know, the reciprocation back? I know this person loves me back. What do I do about it? Even these are the questions which may come in into your mind. Please feel free to have these clarified. And there was one thing which Dr. Ali was just mentioning to you, that we always feel that it's easy to fall in love with some other person, but to fall in love again with the same person, we are having some very interesting questions which have come up. And that's where we were he was mentioning that the grass we feel is greener on the other side. So if you want to see the greener side of the grass, which is there with you, ask Ali. So we are ready for questions, and you can please feel free to ask us, and Dr. Ali will clarify for you.
Yeah. As Purnima said, yes, there are a lot of questions, but before that, can I ask you a question? I've been asking this very frequently. All those of you who have been through DCS and all that know about it. I hope you have even introspected when I've asked you this question. My question is very simple. Given a choice, do you think it is better to love or to be loved? Would you like to develop the love in your heart and your mind and make, you know, express that love and share that love with someone? Or are you more keen that I should be loved, I deserve to be loved, I want to be loved, I crave to be loved? If you fall in the second category, love is not going to come to you very easily. You remember that very touching little proverb which says, happiness is like a butterfly. You try to catch it and it always keeps running away. Very difficult to catch a butterfly. But you grow flowers for it and it will come and sit on your shoulder. I've not had a butterfly sitting directly on my shoulder, but I've had butterflies coming very close to me and sitting right close to me when I'm sitting on my little roof garden among flowers. They get attracted and they come. And they don't get scared of this huge bulky fellow hanging around in between the flowers. They come very comfortably to me. That's what happens with love. If you develop that love in your heart. And how do you do that? See, earlier, the first time that you fell in love, it happened impulsively. Ah, that brings me to another question. What happens if you've never fallen in love at all? Then you say, what do you mean fall in love again? I haven't fallen in love first time. Whatever your age is, if it is beyond 3 years of age, and if you have not yet fallen in love, you missed out something great in life. I think I started falling in love, not at 3 maybe, but by 4 or 5, definitely I was falling in love. It's an enjoyable thing. So what you do this time is rationally work towards falling in love. So first thing is that you tell yourself that this person and I have a bond. We have a commitment. This is my parent. This is my sibling. This is my best friend. This is my child. This is my partner. We have this bond. We have this commitment. Now it's up to me whether I just allow it to drift and live as strangers under one roof, or whether I start, you know, nurturing it. So all you have to do is to start looking for those unusual good qualities. Let's say the person, the object of your love, is a good singer, or at least is a singer. Let's not put the word good. Person likes to sing, and you like to listen to songs. You just tell this guy that whether you sing nicely or not is secondary, but I would like to listen to you. I have this particular song, you know, which is my favorite. Would you like to sing that for me? I'm giving you such a small, you know, example that you will say, what's so great about it? But the falling in love for the second time is based on these very small things. Okay, if you're lucky, you may fall in love because your partner or whoever it is does something really great for you and you say, oh my, I never realized that at a time of crisis, this person is going to be so good to me. So I've fallen in love. But you can't wait for that. It may happen, it may not happen. What you have to do is to start now doing these little things. Going off on a little holiday. And when you say holiday, what are you talking about? The whole nation is under lockdown. Can you take a holiday to the nearest Panipuri fellow who gives you takeaways which you can, you know, take from there and stand 5 feet away and have, but you share. You get one plate of Panipuri and you alternate and you tell each other how good it was or something of that sort. We haven't done that for a long time. Let's do it now. You make gestures or doing something for the other person which the other person enjoys. I'm not going to take too much of your time if you understand the spirit behind what I'm saying. If you make up your mind that I have a commitment to this relationship, the choice is mine either to crib, be unhappy, be sad and just drag on, or to fall in love again with that person, look for those small, tiny good qualities. Sometimes you don't get good qualities or whatever it is, you still go ahead with the thing. Sometimes you don't get reciprocation, you get the satisfaction that I have fallen in love. I remember this friend of mine when we were youngsters, he said that, you know, I'm so happy and I've found the ideal partner and this and that. So he said, so what now? Is it going to be marriage? He said, yeah, my marriage is 50% fixed. What do you mean 50% fixed? He said, 100% from my side, 0% from the girl's side. I'm very happy. This is what I want you to understand. You have to nurture that when you have love in your heart, and that's what everybody, every great man, you look at the great saints and seers, what did they do? When Jesus Christ said, turn the other cheek, what was he doing? He was expressing his love and compassion, which went far beyond revenge or anger or hatred. Is it better to be angry and, you know, looking for revenge and hating people? Or is it better to be in love with people? And it starts with your nearest and dearest. Those who want, I can spend time individually talking about how you go about it, depending on your state of mind or the specific question. Like somebody asked, a teenager falling in love with a 26-year-old, do you think that is a crush? I wouldn't like to generalize answers for these type of things. I'd like to deal with it on an individual basis. And I want to repeat one thing which I keep on trying to repeat, but you know, nobody listens to me, and that is, I am not busy. I am totally jobless. I am available and I enjoy interacting with people, particularly on human behavior issues. So let's start off. Very important point Nandini has brought us. Love oneself. Only then you can keep cherishing and bounce back every time something goes wrong. While in principle, I agree with Nandini, but I also know of people who for whatever reason don't love themselves. It is circumstances. It is regrets. It is low self-esteem. What I want to tell you is that even if you don't love yourself, you can still love others. You can still have a very good loving relationship with others. So don't let that, you know, hamper you. Both I prefer and I get really fascinated to be in love and to be loved. Yes, of course. It should be that way ideally, but it doesn't happen all the time. So given a preference, I would say I would rather love than be loved. Because if I'm loved by the wrong person whom I don't love, that's irritating, isn't it? On the other hand, when I choose to love somebody, in the extreme case that I don't get reciprocation or I get less reciprocation, it's perfectly okay with me. You feel you want to fall in love again, but stop at skepticism of the recipient. Yes, it happens. It definitely, happens. If you have been neglecting that relationship and suddenly you start making these efforts. There was this wife, who suddenly became very loving to her husband. Hey, you look so nice in that blue colored t-shirt. I've ironed it and kept it for you. Why don't you wear that? Why don't we do this? You like that bhel puri? Why don't we go have that? 2, 3, 4 things she said, and the husband, kept staring at her and said, how much money do you want? Because that is a very clear signal that they had allowed their relationship to deteriorate to the level where, they had taken it for granted that they are committed to each other or they are interacting with each other only for their own needs. So if she's being exceptionally nice to me, she probably wants me to give her some money or something of that sort. So don't get angry when the husband says this. Use it as a wake-up call to say, I have to go about it. He will be skeptical. Doesn't matter. It takes time. It takes effort. It's a lifelong relationship that you are looking at. One needs to be extremely generous to love and not be loved in return. I agree with you 100%, Mr. Vignesh. We have to, be very generous. And only when you're generous, you get back something. But this generosity is a little different. You go to a bank and you deposit money and say, I will come back after 1 year and you have to give me interest along with the principal. You're not being generous to the bank. You are giving away your hard-earned money to the bank because it's an investment. You're going to get it back with so much interest. The same thing happens in relationships. Somehow I'm unable to agree that love cannot be unconditional. I think with practice and awareness, it can be, maybe not with all, but whom we want to be, so says Shakuntala, right? Next time your husband says that I have got a very good girl, she's so attractive, she's so nice. I want to get her over for dinner. Will you cook some nice things for both of us? Yes, my husband, unconditional love, I will do it. And you cook that wonderful dinner and he brings this beautiful young girl and he says, I want to have some private moments for her. Can you go out for a walk and leave us alone? Yes, unconditional love, I will leave you alone. In fact, I'll pack up and go to my mother's house. You can keep her for tonight. I mean, I'm exaggerating. But it's just to show you that we are human, no? That unconditionality has to stop at some point. Ah, how can you fall in love when the person lives on the other side of the globe? Nowadays, all that has gone. In fact, some other time I'd like to share with you how the great writer and thinker Khalil Gibran was in love with a woman who lived the other side of the globe. Much, much before any internet or telephone connections came. A letter from him written in USA used to reach his lover in Egypt 20 days later. So the earliest he would get a reply is about 45 days after he's written. But he continued, both of them continued to be madly in love with each other till he died. They never met. It is possible. Today, distances really should not mind you. Yes, those who say that I'd like to meet you personally, most welcome. Just give a call and check, in case I'm out or I'm in some webinar like this or something of that sort. But otherwise, it's a pleasure. Please come, or if you want to talk on phone or something of that sort. JT says, I have a friend going through not so good time as per her. She feels she was loved because she's a good singer and she's a very good cook. But with the passing of years, she's dead busy with other things in life. So doesn't have time for music and neither she cooks every day, etc. She feels her husband's love for her has vanished. Fair enough. Husband's love for her has vanished. But can she still love her husband? Let her look inwards. Yes, she is not loved as for whatever it is. She is hurt. She is confused. But if she keeps banging her head saying, my husband should love me, it doesn't work out. If she says, I love my husband, he's got some good qualities. There are certain times when we can spend some quality time with each other. I'm not going to be emotionally dependent on him. certain things where I, my love for music or this or that, if I can't fulfill with my husband, I'll do it with other friends or whatever it is. But I am going to fall in love again with this person. Try it out and see.
Ali, there's a question asked that it is difficult to fall in love with the same person because I'm becoming very judgmental. So how can I help myself? So if
judgmental people are headed towards a pandemic called loneliness. The more judgmental you are, the more you're isolating yourself, not just against that one person, because it becomes a habit. If you allow judgmentalism to become part of your personality or your psyche, it just starts expanding. It's, as I said, like a pandemic. And you start resisting more and more and more people. You start building walls and cutting off bridges. And before you know it, you are totally isolated from that, not only that person, but from many others. And you head toward loneliness and you become a very bitter person saying that nobody loves me, nobody cares for me and all these sort of things. I keep seeing these things happening. Please take, there is vaccination against this pandemic of loneliness. We can work on it. We don't have to wait till vaccine comes for COVID and all that. That will take its own time. But these things we can definitely do. How does one let go of feelings of being used in relationships, especially when past ones have been based on it? Yes, every individual and therefore every relationship is unique. Somebody has used me. Somebody has misused me. Somebody has been bad to me. Somebody has cheated me. Now, that does not mean that I have to carry that to the next person. Huh. With the same person, you have to ask yourself a serious question. If I'm convinced that this person is not worth loving, and I just have to continue with whatever commitment I have towards that person, even nothing wrong with that. Sometimes you are forced to do that. I do not like my parent at all. It's very difficult for me to fall in love again with my parent because my parent continues to do things which are extremely irritable. I tried my best. Then you accept it and you say, while there is going to be no love over here, but I fulfill my duty and I do whatever I can. In all other cases, you have to move on. Prasad has asked a very interesting question. Is there a term called true love or virtual love? Huh. Nowadays, everything is virtual. So why not love, isn't it? No, Prasad, I don't think we need to differentiate like that. As I said, you can live the other end of the globe and still have a very genuine, warm, caring, loving relationship. You can be living under the same roof 24/7 and not manage to love the person you are sharing your life with. These are realities of life. Sometimes we have to accept it. So it's not an ideal situation. When I say fall in love, it doesn't mean that every one of us can do it and we can do it with everyone and whoever we are with or something of that sort. There are difficulties. There are times when you have to actually let go of a relationship. Either you let go completely or you let go emotionally and say, I will remain committed to the extent of my responsibility and duty. Nandini says, technology has spoiled things. Most of us have forgotten delayed gratification. Absolutely right. It is true. But it is not technology which has spoiled things. It is we who have allowed technology to spoil things, isn't it? If you say that the rain caused cold, cough and pneumonia to me, no. You allowed the rain to fall over you. You went out when it was raining without an umbrella or whatever it is. You didn't come back and change your clothes and whatever it is. Now, you can't blame the rain and say that I am sick because of the rain. The rain will continue to have. Technology will continue to advance. You cannot change that. One of the most important things to remember is technology can be a wonderful slave and a most horrible master. The moment you allow technology to become a master, the most, the moment you get into that FOMO attitude, F-O-M-O, fear of missing out. I have to be connected to my screen all the time. From the time I wake up to the time I go to sleep, What does it mean you have made technology your master? And the technology and a master can be very, very cruel.
Ali, I was just thinking if this was answered, that how important it is to express through verbal communication, even though we have been with the spouse for so many years.
Yeah.
So what is, you know, how
it's very interesting. I keep bringing this up even in our counseling course classes. Do you know how difficult it is to say the simple words, I love you, in your mother tongue? Most Indian languages do not have a simple equivalent of I love you. In fact, I have students saying, no, when I have to say I love you, it depends on whether it is my husband I'm talking to or whether my son. I can't say the same words to both of them. Why can't you? What's so great about it? Why can't you just say I love you? Okay, even if you have the right words, the next question that comes is, how often do you say it now when you have had a nice, settled, established and a routine relationship? Love has to be expressed both verbally, non-verbally. Touch plays a very important role. Not during pandemic, unfortunately. But even in pandemic, when you are living with that person, when you love that person, obviously that person is not going to get COVID and hand it over to you. So you don't have to keep physical distance or social distance from your loved ones. No, it plays a very important role. Please remember that. And the third is, love is also expressed by actions, doing gestures, helping out a person, doing something unexpected. These are the three levels at which you express your love: verbally by saying I love you, non-verbally by actions, holding hands, giving a hug, whatever else you can do, and by actions, doing gestures which express your love and concern and how important the other person is to you. Surekha says, how can we build emotional immunity against certain unpleasant traits of the people we love? Yes, here the herd immunity that we are talking about in COVID doesn't apply, because here we are talking about a one-to-one relationship. So when you realize that there are certain unpleasant traits of the person whom you love, and that person is not going to change, that person is not going to reciprocate, whatever you do, the person is continuing to be unpleasant to you, you have to build up an emotional wall. It takes time, it takes effort, but it can be done. Depending on the circumstances, depending on how close you are to that person, depending on how assertive or how aggressive that person is, we can work these things out. I don't want to give general, but it can be done. That's all I want to tell you. Once you develop that emotional immunity and you build an emotional wall, the person can be doing a lot of unpleasant things to you. You can still continue to maintain a relationship with that person and yet not get hurt by whatever the person is saying. JT says, I feel love requires giving space, and she has put a lot of dots between space. Agreed. Definitely you have to give space in long-term relationships. I really wonder at people, who don't let go. I remember one of my students, when she called up her daughter and said that I'm getting delayed, you don't mind, but I've been out of the house for a long time, but it'll take me another 1 hour. Is it okay? And the daughter said, thank you, mommy. Teenage daughter wanted to be alone and enjoy. Maybe she's put on loud music, maybe she's snacking, maybe she's talking all sorts of scandalous things to her friends. So, and mommy is not there, it's a good time for her. Why do you feel that, no, as a mother, I have to be there? I love my child, I have to take care of all the needs. Yes, you take care of the basic needs of your child, but give space. I agree 100% with Jayati. Hari says, in fact, technology helped us on gratitude. We had 21 days webinars on gratitude. Fantastic. Yes, yes. That's what I said. You're using technology as a slave. You're using it as a means that even if there's a lockdown or something of that sort, I can still be connected to people. I can still get inputs from knowledgeable people and things like that. So I've used technology as a slave, and it has given me so much of wonders.
In fact, Ali, at this time, I would like to, actually thank so many of our well-wishers who really, wish good for us and keep giving us a lot of compliments. And as, yes, it is our mission. And if you can also spread this message to as many people as possible, we'll be more than happy to make this world a happy place.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I agree. Ali says, in fact, technology, you know, sorry, Alice says that I heard love is trust, love is respect, love is caring. It is absolutely true, Alice. Love is not a standalone emotion. Love, you know, goes up and down. Sometimes in minutes, you may be madly in love with the person and the person says one nasty thing to you. And at that moment, you don't love that person, you hate him. Doesn't matter. It's a passing thing. 5 minutes later, you will control yourself and you'll say, okay, but he's like that, what to do? He didn't mean it or something of that sort. But what remains with you and what nurtures love and a commitment and a happy relationship on a long-term basis is exactly what Alice said. That is trust, respect, caring, and I would like to add one more, commitment. That is what. Yes.
There's also a thought which has come in that in a strong relationship, there is no need to have a second person coming in, which you did mention.
Yes, 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 absolutely. I always tell people whenever there is a pati, patni or woh situation, the woh can come in between the pati and patni only if they create space, if they are not sitting tight and, you know, close to each other. If they start drifting, there is a place created for that woe to come in, and that woe need not be a human being. It could be a bottle of liquor, it could be any other form of addiction, it could be gambling, it could be just running away, it could also be workaholism. The person just wants to, you know, deluge himself into work because he doesn't want to go home. So many such things keep coming. Pushpa said, would like to understand better about emotional wall. Yes, as I said, we will. You can get in touch and we can definitely talk about it.
Ali, I was just thinking that, you know, there are also questions which say that I love, but then I don't get the reciprocation and I don't get what I really wanted.
Yeah,
so if we can just tell a little about empathy.
Yeah, it happens. You have to tell yourself that love is not like a debit and credit in an accounts page where the outgoing and incoming have to match at the bottom of the page exactly. It doesn't work that way. You get it in different ways. There's this girl who may say that I love my husband so much. I always express my love. I give him a hug. I tell him all sorts of nice things. I do so many things to help him and be nice to him on a daily basis. But he doesn't reciprocate. I talk to the husband and the husband says, I work so hard because I love her so much that I want her to have a roof on her over her head regardless of whether I'm dead or alive. So I made it an ambition and in the next 2 years, I'm going to work so hard that my wife is going to have a house of her own in her own name and insured so that even if I die, nothing will happen to it. That's his way of expressing love. That is what I want you to understand as we come towards the end of the program. That Navina says that accepting a person with imperfections is falling in love again. Wonderful. Very well said, Navina. Also very well pointed out that the understanding needs and wants, that is of coffee and dinner. Exactly. That's what, those are the small things which help you to understand. The husband may say, she's so irritating. I have a cup of coffee she can't give me. The wife says, I love him so much. I'm concerned about his health and I'm trying to tell him and he's getting angry with me. Now both of them are going off on a tangent. Even there, they can stop, they can introspect, they can get back and they can fall in love again. That I am fully convinced. It for years and decades, I have been watching human behavior and relationships closely. Take it from me that this is personal observations, not something from books and theories. How to go about it, how to take it forward, and how to proceed on this. Just be with us for one more minute, and Seema will close up and tell you what could be the next step. Over to Seema.
Ali, thank you for another lovely session. Actually, this topic on love, which Ali covered in 1 hour, you know, last year we had a camp for 2 days. We have a residential retreat called Manthan and we all stayed there and we enjoyed the sessions back to back. So a lot of introspection, a lot of sharing. So all that happens in Banjara and more. And like I was telling you, the next topic will be happiness is a journey and create inner happiness. So these are, you know, the next upcoming series. So please log in again next Saturday. Next Saturday is also a very important day here because we are launching our 22nd batch of Diploma in Counseling Skills. So we have the first class on 22nd, on the coming Saturday. So see you all again on Saturday and wish you all the best and enjoy yourself and always be in love. Thank you so much.